Not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him because he abides in you, and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day you will know that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me, and those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Not a missionary, friend Silas and Timothy to join him. And while he's hanging out, Paul goes about Athens like a tourist, soaking up the history and culture, visiting its many magnificent sites and its attractions. And he comes across an altar with an inscription, "To an unknown God." To an unknown God. And it was that inscription that sent Paul into a frenzy. Now, I want to give you a better understanding of today's reading, so I'm going to read the preceding six verses which lead into our Acts reading for today. And it begins like this. While Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was deeply distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he argued in the synagogue with the Jews and the devout persons, and also in the marketplace every day with those who happened to be there. Also, some Epicurean and Stoic philosophers debated with him. Some said, "What does this blabber want to say?" Others said, "He seems to be a proclaimer of foreign divinities." This was because he was telling the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. So they took him and brought him to the Areopagus and asked him, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? It sounds rather strange to us, so we would like to know what it means." Now all the Athenians and the foreigners living there would spend their time in nothing but telling or hearing something new. In other words, there were people who loved to debate, who loved to discuss, who were engaged in expanding their knowledge. But understand that Paul was naturally offended by idols, because devout Jews believed that idols were an abomination to God. But the thing that most incensed him was that altar with that inscription, "To an unknown God." And that is what sets off the debate that we read about in today's lesson. The Areopagus, by the way, is somewhat like a city council that hears public debates and then renders the verdicts, a little mightier than our vestry. Of course, these folks think that Paul is a blabber, talking nonsense, but they're willing to give him a chance to explain what he has to say, more out of curiosity and amusement than anything else. And that gives Paul the opportunity to make his points. And he preaches to them a sermon. Make no mistake, this is a sermon that Paul is preaching to the Athenians. And the point he makes is that building an altar to an unknown God is like trying to cover all your bases because your religion is inadequate. In other words, in case you missed one, because you have the God of rain, the God of sun, the God of wind, the God of everything else. But just in case you missed one, let's make this altar to an unknown God. And Paul promises to tell him who that God is. The greater point that Paul makes is that their method of searching for the one true God is defective and pointless. God is not trying to hide from anyone. Quite the opposite is true. And he quotes one of their own philosophers to prove that point. In him, we live and move and have our being. ways and unwilling to change. Fame and possession, for example, they don't usually yield deep satisfaction. And we live in a world that seems less and less compelled to worship God, trusting instead in power, in violence, and dominance, all while failing to realize that God is in and with each and every one of us. And our search for wholeness will not be satisfied until we realize that in Him we live and move and have our being. And that's very countercultural these days, because we live in a culture that tells us, in a sense, that life is a game where the person who gets to the end with the most money wins. And these are shallow pursuits. And these pursuits, however, can turn into idols when they replace the deeper searches for meanings. All idols, whether physical or material or mental, become a contradiction to faith in God the Creator. Like the Athenians, sometimes we seem to be covering all our bases, reaching for an experience of the divine. And that idol doesn't stay out of our churches either, because every attempt by human beings to capture God in images, in a book, in a temple, in a people, or in a culture, in a religious experience, or in an institution, is a denial of the Spirit. I say it often, and I will say it again, and I'm going to especially say it towards the end of my time here. The church is not the building. The church is not the building. Please keep that in mind. You are the church. You are, as Peter said in one of our readings in previous weeks, you are living stones. But we do this, we do this useless assault on God's power in the name of demon power. Another desperate bid that's created out of fear to define the unknown, the unpredictable, and the unmanageable future that God promises us. Because deep down inside our sinful selves, we want to be like God. But what that first article of the Creed tells us, God is God, and we are not. So let us not reach so far in our search for a God who, after all, is not far from each one of us. In our search, our groping, as Paul puts it, can end at the communion table, where we dine together, where God is placed into our hands, and where we are reminded that God has come and will come again in Jesus Christ. In God we live and move and have our being. The object of our search is right here, with us and within us. We human beings are God's creatures. Those who may believe in other gods are also God's creatures. And just as God is in us, God is in them. We are all God's creatures. through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate in the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified in Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Page 387 in the Book of Common Prayer. Father, we pray for your Holy Catholic Church.
That we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you.
That we may be glorified by all people.
We pray for our bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacrament.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let the light of perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May all of us share in the kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others. All those on our prayer list, parishioners, friends and family, first responders, and those in the armed forces. We pray for whoever our next rector will be, that God will give them the spirit of an advocate with a deep love for our church and community. We offer thanks for the blessings you have given to us. The birthdays of Stephanie, Chloe, John, Alice, Carly, and Beth, and the anniversary of Art and Kathy.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, peace I give to you, my own peace I leave with you. Regard not our sins, but the faith of your church, and give to us the peace and unity of that heavenly city, for with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us greet each other with the sign of Christ's peace. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering. you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen."
Thank you.
please come forward for your blessings. All the days of her life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.